मालविका,
Yes, ma'am.
We can start, Malavika. The chairperson have joined and the speaker and all the MC members have joined. So we can start.
Good evening, Malavika. I'm Hari. Event co-chair, Students Activity Council, CSI Trivandrum chapter. Welcome you all to the CSI Weekly Talk series. On every Thursday, I will mine through the section by a tech enthusiast. Today's section is about sequence model, how machine learn to be a poet to a musician. I bid a warm welcome to all those who took their valuable time and joined. So let me assistant professor Engineering College, Barton Hill. She has more than 14 years of experience in teaching and technical field. She is also the core member of Students Activity Council, CSI Trivandrum. Now, over to you, ma'am.
Malavika, I'm very happy to be the session chair for today's tech talk. Is organized by Computer Society of India Trivandrum chapter. Let me introduce today's speaker. Enthusiastic person for session. He is none other than Aurangzeb AK. He is an energetic person. He has taken his tech in mechanical engineering and M-Tech production and industrial engineering. And he took his B-Tech in 2016 and M-Tech in 2019. More than 2 years industrial experience, his first experience was as a data science solutions engineer and training head at us. Astrum Analytics Kochi. He was there for almost one and a half years. Currently, he is working with BrainWired Kochi as a machine learning engineer. And he is a IBM certified and with him, like 11. IBM authorized and verified digital badges. One of the distinguished speaker at management. MIT Global Business School Kochi and has through online universities, like for example, from Stanford University, and he has certification for TensorFlow. And I think we today's session. I welcome Aurangzeb for today's session.
Hello.
Welcome, Aurangzeb. Over to you.
Everyone, good evening.
Yes, everyone.
So good evening.
Yes, we can hear you.
Good evening to Mubarak. Thank you, Joe. So, given an opportunity to share experiences with Computer Society of India. It's actually a quite I believe it's an session. So I'm going to share the slide. new cutting edge technologies. So that is one objective. Then the next thing is understand, like when we first hear the term sequence model, it might not interest you that much, which is what I thought at first when I was learning sequence models. So we'll, after, I believe, I hope I can impart some interesting aspects of what sequence models can achieve. So, and finally, develop a curiosity towards sequence models. That means I want to interest, arouse an interest in each one of you here to dig deep about what is sequence model, what can I do with sequence models, and all those things. So I hope I can impart all these objectives to you guys. The slide change. Okay, so initially, what are sequences? So when we discuss about sequences, some examples will be, first of all, what is sequence? So sequence is something that we define technically as time series of objects. So when I say time series of objects, I mean, you can take a sentence. So sentences may be, I have a car. So I have a car. If you like alter the order in which those words appear, then you will still get a sequence, but that sequence will be meaningless. So order or something, or order or some kind of arrangement are built into sequences, and that is one reason why we call them sequences. So one example is sentence, and sentence is something that we use on our day-to-day life while we are conversing with each other. So sentence is one example of sequence in which each word in a sentence becomes an object. That means at first instance of time, you speak like, if the sentence is about I have a car, I is the first time object, have is the second time object, a is the third time object, and car is the fourth time object. So it's a time series of objects. And another example is your music. So music is actually basically a collection of signals. And again, just like sentences, if you alter its order, if you alter its sequence, you will still get music, but it will be not the original, and it will most probably be meaningless. Again, movie. So movies are again collections of frames. That is why movies are also known as motion pictures. So its movies are also a kind of sequences. So what is a model? So first of all, when we hear the term model, there are so many things that we might come across. That means if you are speaking about the apparel industry, that means a new celebrity posing as a fashion model to exhibit a new dress designed by a famous designer. So that can be a model. Then a model, what some of you might have heard about is like in science exhibition, working models. So there are so many models. So what exactly is a model? So model in layman's terms basically means understanding of a concept. So if you are learning maths, like if you are learning maybe geography, and if you are learning something about different continents, after learning, going through that chapter, you will develop a model about continents of the world. So that is meant by a model. So model is an understanding. So when you're going for a professional degree, you're building up a model of a degree of your choice. That is the stream of your choice. If you're going for computer science, you will rewire your brain to gain an understanding about how computer works, how computer can be used to make business values, and all those stuff. So understanding in simple terms, we can give an give example as explaining a movie to a friend. Imagine you are watching a movie. A movie is two and a half hour. But when you explain it to him, it won't last like even up to 2.5 hours. It might end, maybe if you are too much elaborate, you might go up to maybe 10 or 15 minutes, but not more than that. So what you're doing is that while going through the 2.5 hours, you were developing a model of that movie inside your brain. And using that model, you compass that model and convey that to your friend. So that model. And then another thing is singing your favorite song in the shower. So when you're singing this song, like you might have sung maybe 5 minutes before, maybe 2 days before, maybe 1 month before. Again, when you're listening to that music for the first time, maybe for the second time, you are building up a model of that song. That is an understanding of that song. How does the melody change? So you are making an understanding, or technically we say we are developing you developed a model about that song. So only because you made a very good model. If you are a very good singer, then what we can say is that you developed a very good model about the music that you heard, a song you heard, and it was you were too good at understanding the model, or you were too good at building that model. You are singing singing almost as if like the original. So that is what is meant by a model. So next thing, so let's quickly review what is like definitions of AI, or what does AI mean. So the fundamental aim of AI is to mimic intelligence. So human intelligence, we mean by that we mean we observe the nature and we take actions accordingly. So if we see a car coming towards our direction while we are walking through the streets, we will move away from the road to a safe point. So we look at the environment, we act accordingly. So that is actually human intelligence. So AI aims to do that. So first of all, what we have to understand is that AI is an interdisciplinary subject. That is, when you're looking at, like, if you're walking across the street, you might be seeing so many billboards, you might be seeing so many vehicles going to and fro, you might be like watching, listening to music at the same time. So there are so many things going on. So many laws of physics acting, laws of biology acting, laws of chemistry acting, so many things are happening. So when we are developing something obviously maths is very much involved. When we are developing applications or we are doing something related to AI, what we have to remember is that it is heavily involved, because the universe is actually interdisciplinary. So if as human beings we interact with all those things, so if we are successful with all those things, that means we are successfully interacting with the interdisciplinary things. So if we are successful in that, we are enabling the machines to do the same thing. So to do such a thing, the first, like, we are the teacher to the machine. So the teacher should know the interdisciplinary thing to effectively teach the student, in this case, in whatever we want to make it do. Just like we do, the machine should do. So that is one case. So how can we replicate human intelligence? So human intelligence, like, only if we can replicate human intelligence, that means only if we can somehow create what we do to the, like, for a given situation, what will we do to a machine, only then that machine can act accordingly. So to do that, we need some form of understanding, or some kind of a technique. So that technique is known as quantification. So for example, if, like, imagine you have a smartphone and it detects your smile. It has a smile detection feature. So first of all, if you're actually, what the smile detection is actually a functionality of AI. So how does the AI achieve that smile detection? So smile detection if it has to be achieved, first of all, you will have to define what you mean by a smile. How will you distinguish between a smile and someone who is crying? So you will have to mathematically put down these steps. That means if you are smiling, your lips will turn at this amount of angle, and it will like it will go up vertically this much unit. So there is some kind of measurement involved. So that is how we aim, like that is how we can communicate what we do to the machines. So again, another thing is statistical models. So statistical models, for example, if you are like, maybe imagine you are a person who usually goes to, like if you're employed and if you usually go to your office via some kind of private bus, and imagine you are going via private bus maybe for 1 year. And suppose after comes to you and asks you about like, how is your experience with via travel with private bus? You will give an opinion. And maybe during that 1 year, you might have chosen another transportation medium, maybe auto rickshaws. So, but again, you will have a strong opinion about this private bus as well as auto rickshaw. Maybe you had a bad experience from auto rickshaw. Maybe that is the reason why you sticked on with the private bus. So what you did was that you made a statistical model about private bus inside your brain, even with your conscious mind knowing. So that is actually the power of the brain. Our subconscious mind is so powerful that it can make statistical models just by, like, we just need to perceive things and subconscious mind will do all these things. So that is one thing. And how, after doing all these things, that is just the starting point. How can we perfect this AI? Because, excuse me, that is like, even if we do all these things, the machine will learn to do stuff that we do, but still not with the same efficiency as us. So how can we perfect that? So to do that, again, a person who is involved or who is interested to go into AI will have to look through a philosophical viewpoint. By philosophy, I mean, philosophy is actually a branch of knowledge which deals with the way how we think. It's a branch that like questions about how do we think. So since AI is an emerging domain, we are having newer problems. Newer problems means for which solutions are only just emerging. So if we want to solve newer problems, we'll have to have newer thoughts. If you need to have newer thoughts, you definitely need to have a philosophical viewpoint. So in philosophy, there is a common topic that there's a very popular theory or a rule that is known as a rule of parsimony. So the basically what it means is never complicate things unnecessarily. That means if you are making a model, if you start with a simple model first and then you analyze that model and then you understand that model is so simple it cannot deal with complicated, that means that model can't do as us. That means we can like listen to music at the same time and maybe do some activity. Maybe we can eat our food while listening to music. So that is actually multitasking. So again, this is actually just for your like reference. This is a rule that is we fundamentally use to perfect AI. That means build something very simple first and then gradually work your way up to complicated things. So that is the basic philosophy. So let's go on to some terminologies. So I believe some of you might have seen Christopher Nolan's movie, The Tenet. So Tenet, like Christopher Nolan is a Hollywood actor who is perceived to be showcasing extremely like mind-boggling sci-fi movies. So the reason, one reason is that he is one of a kind director who like displays scientific principles in the like interesting way as possible. That means his movies are like a textbook, but it's not like textbook. Like it explains things what textbooks can't do. That means a textbook can only explain just the theories in sentences. For example, if some of you might have seen this movie, the core theme of this movie is about entropy. So you might have heard about entropy in your maybe chemistry class, and you might have heard of its definition as degree of disorderness. That is, definition of entropy as degree of disorderness. So in this movie, what the core theme is about is entropy. So entropy, when we hear the term, it might be like, we might feel like it's quite complicated, but when we see the movie, it's actually very simple. That is, in our world where entropy is going forward, when we clap our hands, first clapping happens, then comes the sound. But in a world where the entropy is reversed, first the clapping noise happens, and then the clapping happens. That is the reversal of cause and effect. Again, another philosophical concept. First, in our world, cause happens first, effect happens second. But in this movie, what Christopher Nolan has shown, that due to some kind of physical phenomenon, this was reversed. That is, effect happens first, then happens the cause. So the reason why I brought this here is that the reason, like, how Christopher Nolan's movies are showcasing complex scientific theories that is easily understandable by like any common person. That is, the visual form of communication is the most powerful and easiest to digest for majority of us. So, and Christopher Nolan is showing that. So let me give an example in our domain, that is in the domain of AI. So suppose I'm telling you this sentence, I'm doing a forward propagation with adaptive moment estimate optimizer and captive origin person to activator with softmax and back propagation with a learning rate of 0.001. I basically understood this. I don't expect the professors might have understood it, but I don't believe the students have understood this. So this is actually a very simple statement, but which actually covers or hides the fun behind this. When put in a layman's term, this just means this much. That is, I taught the machine something, the machine learned something, and all these things. Like, instead of saying this simple stuff, what we will see in academic journals are these kinds of stuff: forward propagation, adaptive moment estimate optimizer, categorical Gaussian repeat, softmax, back propagation, learning rate, and blah blah blah. So all those stuff. So, but what happened? Like, what Christopher Nolan does best is break down complex topics into simple things and in visual format so that everybody can understand and in an interesting manner. So this is what I am trying to achieve, like breaking down this complex thing into a very simple phrase. So this is what this means. I taught the machine something. So, and this is just as a starting point. Then, so this is what I was saying. So technical terms actually hides the fun, but fun as well as the practical aspects. So just like what our actual science textbooks fail to do, Christopher Nolan excels on. So that is why his movies are so well, very well received among scientific communities. So then again, hyperparameter tuning. This is again another term that you might stumble across when you are going through academic journals. So it just means hyperparameter tuning is basically some knobs or basically guessing. Those are the norms of your model, the AI, by tuning with which you get the accurate result. That means you first ask the AI to do some work, and you will see that is the work up to your expectation. No, if it's no, then you will turn some random knobs of that machine, and you will keep on turning that knob until you get the desired result. So if I ask you what is the number of rivers in India, you can start guessing until I tell you your answer is correct. And the correct answer is 400 plus. So actually I'm giving a simple insight, that is, hyperparameter tuning is simply put, is just guessing in layman's terms. So if all these things are scaring you off, just remember this, like from by the American astrophysicist Neil deGrasse Tyson, like, always keep the mind of kids, because kids are actually born scientists, and their mind is always asking questions. For example, like if they don't know whether if he or she, that kid puts the, like if he gets hold of a chicken egg in his hands, if he drops that egg, he doesn't know if it will break or not. But he or she will have to first try it. What will happen if I drop this egg? So they are courageous to do that. But what the parents does is that they will restrict the kids from doing that. Or basically parents are spoiling a scientific experiment. So what anyone, so I want to recommend this like phrase from, or this quote from Neil deGrasse Tyson. If you are into AI, be a kid. That means stay curious always. Don't hesitate to experiment. So always keep asking questions, and which is actually fundamental to AI. So then just comparing the AI with our traditional machine learning. So AI is something, why is AI so popular is because of its realistic nature. That is, AI is predict and learn, and we'll see why that is the case in the next slide. And learning to cycle is an example. So we'll go through that example in the next slide. So the cycle means learning to ride the bicycle, and we'll see that in the next slide. So AI is actually a non-parametric model. So non-parametric model means a model or a theory that does not make use of any assumptions. So for an example, initially Newton came up with the discovery of gravity, then came Einstein with his quantum physics. Newton, with his theory, he proposed his theory with so many assumptions, and with that assumptions he said there is something known as gravity. And later on Einstein came with his own set of assumptions and his own general theory of relativity, and he said that with his quantum physics theory he said that gravity does not exist, and still the world has not been able to prove Einstein wrong. So what does this mean? So there is generally saying that while we are developing any theory, a model or an understanding, assumptions limits our learning. So if you assume too much about anything, you will fail to see the whole perspective of the things. So AI is like, so Einstein, why did Einstein succeed in finding out that there is no such thing known as gravity? And why did Newton fail to see that there is no such thing known as gravity? So that is the reason. That is, Newton had some wrong assumptions, or he relied on assumptions too much, while Einstein had fewer number of assumptions. So fewer the number of assumptions, greater will be your understanding of the universe. Just like Einstein, he had better grasp of universal laws, hence his theory was proven to be much more greater than Newton's, and his theories stood the test of time. So AI is like Einstein. That means it uses relatively or almost zero assumptions. That is, it is a perfect model compared to your traditional machine learning models. Just remember that. Okay. Then, traditional machine learning, what it does is that it first learns and then predicts. That is, like in the first case, in the case of AI, what is happening is, just like I said, it is realistic learning. Like imagine you're starting to cycle. You first do some random steps, you might fall down, but still you will try to ride the bicycle, even though you perfectly know you don't know how to cycle. So you learn by doing. So you predict. That means you first predict that this cycle should be cycle handle should be held in this manner. You will just arrive at a prediction. That means you predict this should be done in this manner. But at the moment you fail, you fall from the bicycle, you will understand that your predictions, that means your assumptions were wrong. So while you stand up, you ride again, you fall down, you ride again, you fall down, you keep on doing that until you perfectly. So that is what AI, that is the workflow of AI. But what traditional machine learning is doing is just like a nerd student. That is, he does not first of all get into a bicycle, he'll go first to the stationery shop or a bookshop. He'll go and buy a book about a tutorial on how to ride a bicycle. He will learn that first, and then he goes to ride the bicycle. So that is what traditional machine learning is doing. So So, and that is something known as the traditional machine learning models belongs to the class of parametric models. Just like I said before, it is a parametric model. It depends too much on assumption, and it is just like our Newton. And hence, compared to Einstein, Newton is less effective. So that is why we see AI emerging in every domain. So parametric and non-parametric, some examples. So evaluate a person's height by his or her age. So you cannot generalize this. That is, even if you find, like, imagine you gathered your maybe 50 friends with a mix of ladies and gents. So even if you collect all their heights and their age, you cannot predict on someone who is an American citizen. So you only have the data of Indian citizen. So the body, the anthropometry, that is the body nature of the sample, that means the data that you have is about Indian citizens. You cannot use the same data on another citizens because they have a different body structure. That means their body statistics is different. So your model will perform good if you rely on one assumption, that is, you will build a model, and this model is for Indian citizens or Indian citizens' age prediction model. In that manner, that model will be accurate. So that is a parametric model. So that is, this is the reason. So very different ways and geography. So it due to this assumption, it learns very less because you can't apply this to an African citizen, American citizen, Australian citizen, British citizen. So that is the case. So some architectures, we'll just quickly go through all those. So vanilla neural network is actually our basic neural network. So this is the case. It will have an input layer. It will have a hidden layer. It will have an output layer. So input layer is where your data goes in, and hidden layer is where the learning happens, and the output layer is where we get the prediction. So this is actually suitable for two kinds of tasks, classification and regression. So classification task, we can say that, like, imagine you are given, you have collected so many blood samples, and you will measure what is the fat deposit in each blood samples. You can arrive at a database. That means person number one, for this blood sample, this is the amount of fat deposit. Or whether there is, like, you can say that whether there is fat deposit in blood or not. So yes or no kind of problem. Or you can say that how much amount of fat is present. So if you are saying, is there blood fat deposit in the blood or not, that is a classification problem. And if you are saying how much amount of fat deposit is present in the blood, then that will be a regression problem. So just for an understanding, I mentioned this architecture. Then comes the second architecture, which is convolutional neural networks, which is specifically used for image processing. So this is just, again, a quick image of what is happening inside this convolutional neural network. You give in an image, and it will predict whether what does that image contain. So that is the basic thing about this. So it is used in the camera filters. You may have heard about face app. That means if you give your image of your current state, it will give you your image after maybe when you are like 50 years or maybe 60 years or maybe 70 years or when you were a teenager. So or when you were like an elementary school student, all those things. So what this is where the convolutional neural network comes in. So this is another architecture. Our core architecture is this. So this is what we are going to focus on. So that is recurrent neural network. So recurrent neural network. The slide thing. Looks like things, huh? With the slide change, huh?
No. Just try to stop again. Sir, should we project the slides for you?
This is stuck. Yeah, it would be nice if you can.
Okay, sir. Sir, is the slides visible?
It was visible.
I think you can. Yeah. Yes, yes, perfect. Aurangzeb, are you there?
There is some network issue. He will rejoin through his phone. That's what he said now. He'll join soon.
Okay.
Hello.
You're audible.
So, am I audible to all?
Yes, you are audible. You are audible. Carry
on. Okay. So, we are talking about recurrent neural network. So, recurrent neural network is basically your forward feed, that is your vanilla neural network, but just with one thing, it has a memory. That means if we give an input now, it will remember its outcome for that corresponding to that input, and then it will accept the next input. In this case, we can see that the unrolled format. So in the unrolled format, we'll see that we can see that there is at the bot first we can see the input layer. There is I of 1, I of 2, I of 3, I of 4. So this I1 to I4 is actually our input sequence. So this input sequence, initially when we give I of 1, the just like our vanilla neural network, it will make an understanding inside the hidden layer. So it will make a calculation, it will correspondingly make a number inside the hidden layer, and it will store that whatever number is that inside that layer, and then it will accept the next input. The next input is the next in sequence. If imagine is the sequences maybe car, so like or care, C-A-R-E. So the first alphabet is C, and based on that, it will make a number inside the first in, hidden layer. And as for I2, the alphabet is A. And for that, it will make a corresponding number inside the second hidden layer. Then this continues for throughout the length of the sequence. So what happens is that when you give, what is essentially happening is that when you give a sequence, this model will make an understanding about this input sequence. So this is what you, we mean by sequence model. So next slide, please. So, okay. So LST, so we are, basically we have two architectures for RNN. So first is LSTM, which is actually quite old. It is from 99. It's actually, even though it's old, it's actually still the most advanced sequence model used till now. And the latest one is GRU, which is like LSTM, full form, long short form memory network, and the GRU stands for gated recurrent unit. So again, just as I said, and just to show you guys, I'm not going to enter the details, but just to give you guys the intricacy of LSTM, I have included this figure, which just shows the one, like as I mentioned before, sequence model has something known as a memory. That means if you give an input now, it will get understanding about that input, and it will store that understanding and accept the next input, and while making an understanding of the second input, it will make use of the understanding of the previous input. And that is actually diagrammatically represented in this figure, and which is actually just one memory cell, which we actually call as LSTM cell. So don't get scared about this. I just wanted to show the intricacy of this model. So next slide, please. So the terminology. So to understand the terminologies in RNN, we'll use a simple example as to a kid learning to ride a bicycle, just like we mentioned before. So the basic RNN terminologies is like, it's almost similar. It's mostly similar to your vanilla neural network. If somebody has an understanding about a basic neural network, so weights and biases, basically, like this is a term. All these terms that we'll see in this slide are the terms that you will come across in the maybe in the academic journals. So Weights and bias basically means an understanding. So like you need to understand, that means if you are this kid, and if as a kid, if you want to learn to ride the bicycle for the first time, you will have to randomly make a choice. That means I will have to hold the handle in this manner, I'll have to position my body in this manner, and so on. So that is the weights and bias, that is your understanding. So then comes the forward propagation. Forward propagation means, with this understanding, that is while holding the handle in this particular angle, while positioning your body in this particular angle, you will decide to do a pedaling for the first time, and that is what is known as a forward propagation, and which can be also called as a prediction. That means you will, by using the understanding that you had initially, you will start to pedal, and if you fall down that time, you will automatically arrive at a conclusion that your assumption in the first place, that is your understanding in the first place, was wrong. And that understanding, that is that self-introspection, that means your evaluation about your previous decision, is what is known as the backward propagation or feedback. You fall down and try again with a new understanding. So it's a cycle. And then comes epochs. So epochs is how many times you will try. How many times will you try until you perfect the art of cycling? So if you are determined to learn cycling in a very short period of time, you will be determined to fall many number of times. But what, just like the common proverbs say, goes like, each failure is a stepping stone to success. So even though you fall down 10 times, the 10th fall is actually less intensive than the 9th fall. And as you reach 100th fall, it will be very, very less compared to all the previous falls. And you will reach a stage where you will have perfected cycling. We cannot completely perfect cycling, and cycling will be a continuous, cycling will be a continuous process. So then comes another term, that is encoding. So as a kid who is trying to learn cycling, encoding comes as a translation. That means, imagine you are given instruction from an elderly person. An elderly person, meaning he has a lot of life experience, his words may not be as easily digestible for this kid. So we need to have some kind of translation. That is, we need to convert this complicated instructions into a form that is easily understandable by this kid. So that is what, in this case, meant by encoding. The same case applies as a machine. So an interesting thing, what you have to assume is that the AI is actually the kid. So because in the current age, AI is in its infancy. Exactly as the philosophy goes, AI is a kid, and we as a human are the elderly. That means humans have accrued so much senses so far, and we are actually teaching this kid, which is actually the AI, to learn how to cycle, how to draw pictures, how to sing, and all those stuff. So next slide, please. So then comes LSTM terminologies. To understand that, we'll just assume you are using pen of different brands from class 1 to graduation. So just we can understand the LSTM terminologies with that example. So the context is that this pen is meant for writing, not to play pen fight with your friend, that we know. So that is context, that is what the functionality. Then comes the encounter. So encounter is when you are using the pen. So using the pen means you are using the pen to write notes or impositions, just because maybe your teacher, you failed to complete the homework or something. So that is encounter. Then comes gate. So gate is a term that usually occurs, or it is one of the important terms in LSTM journals. So gate is basically a filter. Filter in the sense, which context should be given preference. That means, just like I said before, a pen can be used for writing, a pen can be used to play pen fight, even though the weightage goes for writing functionality. So gate is something that decides which functionality gates importance. So that is what, just remember that. So LSTM has basically two types of gates, forget gate and update gate. Forget gate, as it says, which should I remember? That is, imagine you're buying maybe a cello pen in class one, and you are using that pen for 1 year, and for these class two, when you're going to the shop to buy a new pen, you might remember that in the previous year when you used the pen of cello, you had a bad encounter with that pen. So you decide to forget that encounter and rewrite, that means update, with a new pen. That is, you will decide, I will go with Reynolds because I had a very bad experience with cello. So I will forget my experiences with cello, and I will use Reynolds from now onwards. So what you did is, you used a past, you had an understanding of cello from the past, and you are going to make a decision in the present about Reynolds pen using the experience you had in the past. So that is what Gabe is doing. Then cell is just a container. Imagine you have, I mentioned previously, this recurrent neural network or the sequence model have something known as memory. So memory is not a physical thing, but yet again, we need to store this memory somewhere. Like you have a computer which has 1 TB of hard disk. That hard disk is actually the cell where the memory resides. We cannot destroy the hard disk and see the memory. We can only see the physical container. So similarly, LSTM also has a cell in which it holds its memory. Again, another term that you might stumble across when you're going to the sequence model journals. So next slide, please. So what happens, like a bird's eye view inside an RNA? So it basically, the first step will be to pre-process the input incoming sequence. So as an example, I have given ABC. So imagine the ABC, the alphabetical index of A is 1, B is 2, and C is 3. So translation of inputs for sequence model basically means you convert the sequence ABC. In this case, ABC is a meaningless sequence because ABC does not mean anything. Again, DEF, again, you translate it to 4, 5, 6. And why are you doing this? Because machines can only see numbers. And in this case, I use 1, 2, 3. It's just for the demonstration purpose. So that is the first step. We process the input sequence. Then we train the model. So training the model is just like giving a textbook that to that infant kid. In this case, the AI or the sequence model. That means textbook, we know a textbook contains questions and answers. So as an example, the question is the input sequence, that is MUSI, and I have given in braces its index location, so index numbers, that is M occurs at 13, U occurs at 21, S occurs at 19, and so on. So if I give you MUSI, what is the element in the sequence? So that is the question, and that is the answer. So if I ask this question for, like, this is just one example, I'll maybe give the machine so many such examples, and the machine will make an understanding. So even if I ask you the same question, if I ask you MUSI and blank, you will maybe most probably will give me the same answer, that is music. So then after doing a lot of training, that is you will give the machine a lot of examples. That means textbook is actually, the textbook given to the machine contains so many encounters. Encounters means so many sequences. From each sequence will be different from each other. And after going through all those, the machine will generate an understanding of the sequences. Finally, we will test the machine on unseen examples. So please press the next button. So as an example, house. So H-O-U-S, what is the next? So obviously, the machine will give you, or most probably it will give you the next alphabet as E. So if the machine fails to do so, we will see that the machine has not yet learned very well. That means we'll have to go to the training section again and continue this. This basically means training or teaching an AI is a continuous process. Yeah, next slide, please. So teaching AI is a continuous process. So what does long, short-term memory do? So I'll use an example. So Tom was happy to have found a juice shop as he was very thirsty. And the next sequence, in this case, previously we were using words. So previously we were using words. Now we are using sentences as sequence. So in the second sequence, we can see that he went in and ordered an orange blank. For humans, we can easily say it will be orange juice. So juice, we got the answer juice because we kept a memory about juice shop in the previous sequence. So this is exactly what RNA is doing. So and for the another example, he was the best dash of the month. You can put best employee of the month, best manager of the month, best student of the month. For this sequence, a single sequence, that means a sequence containing only one sentence, you don't have to keep any memory. You can put anything that is necessary. So in this case, we may not have to use LSTM. We maybe just need to use the basic RNN technique. So that is the case. So LSTM is used for, what I was saying is that LSTM is used for long-term dependency problem. Long-term dependency problem means sequences that involve more than one sentence, which is basically which is our reality. Because when right now I'm giving you this talk, and my talk actually involves maybe thousands of words. So this is basically a problem of LSTM itself. So that's what I was going at. Next slide, please. So the building blocks. So LSTM aims to mock the architecture of human brain, because we as a human, we have two kinds of memory, that is working memory and the long-term memory. Working memory is the short-term memory. That is, if you are assigned a task which is actually quite new to you, or imagine your friend dictates you, imagine you are receiving an OTP in your phone. You will go through that OTP, you will remember it for that second, and you will type it where it is needed. And after that, maybe that minute, you will easily forget that OTP. So that is your short-term memory, which in this case, we say it is the hidden state of LSTM. Then long-term memory, maybe your memory regarding your own mobile number. So that is what is known as the long-term memory, which in technical terms, we call it as cell state. And the gates, forget gate and update gate I mentioned previously, those are basically filters. Filters, in this case, it is a real number, meaning it can be any number between 0 and 1. It can be 0.001 or 0.999, etc. So which basically gives a weightage. And the new memory is given as the current encounter, which will be again a number, into update gate, which will be something between 0 and 1, which will, like, if it's update gate, the value is closer to 1, the current encounter will get higher value, that means higher weightage. And if forget gate value is very closer to 0, that means 0.001, then the previous encounter will get multiplied by that very small number, and it will have very less contribution to the new memory. This is just like basically saying that the current encounter made you choose. That is just like I mentioned the case of the Reynolds pen. The cello pen gave you so bad experience that you are forgetting the your history associated with cello pen. So that in your new memory, the only number that remains is the current encounter into update gate. So that is how, this is basically how the way our human brain works. And just like I mentioned before, we have actually replicated human intelligence by quantifying the human understanding. That is how we choose a pen, a newer brand of pen based on previous experience. So next slide, please. So let's see how to teach a machine to become Shakespeare. So I'm going to share my Google Colab notebook now. Can you please turn off this shared screen so that I can present? Okay. Wait a second, one second. Can everybody see the screen?
Yes, it is visible. It is visible.
Okay. So I'm going to quickly run this code. Okay. Okay, so I'm on Shakespeare's very well known the poems known as group of collection of poems known as the sonnets. So I'm going to train the model on this set of poems. So this is what the code looks like for training. I have actually hidden so many complexities here, so I just want to quickly show this. So what is happening is that you can see that there is something written as loss. So this loss, when you see it, this loss is this as the training goes on, this number, that is this countdown, is the number of examples in input sequence is Shakespeare's poem. So as you can see, the loss is increases. That means it's like we are asking the machine some questions and it is giving us answers, and we are evaluating its answers. And what we are seeing is that as it is learning, it's eventually reducing its loss. That is, it's reducing its negative marks, or basically it is actually learning. That is what this signifies. So it is almost, it has almost finished learning. So let's see. So it has now finished learning, and let's see what. So we have basically made a Shakespeare machine. So let's see what this is asking. So I'm going to input this sentence, so or this beginning sequence. So I'm going to input. That means I'm asking this Shakespeare machine by taking this this make it no sense sentence as input. Please generate a poem as if this was written by Shakespeare. So I'm going to enter this. So we can see that the Shakespeare machine has started writing the poem, but again, you can see that it does not make any sense. That's because this machine has been only trained for only 1000 epochs. 1000 epochs means like for 154 sonnets, we have gone through 1000 times. That means through 154 poems, we went through 1000 times, meaning if you took 5 hours to cover those 154 poems structure. But what we see is that within maybe like 71 seconds, this machine learned at least some of it. Even though it is meaningless, it has learned something. It is writing poems for you. But still, it is meaningless. But you can increase the number of epochs. That means you can increase the number of times the machine can go through. That is, give the textbook for maybe another 1000 times. That is, we are instructing the machine, please read this poem, 154 poems, for 1000 times more, so that you get even more understanding about Shakespeare's time. So this is again another example. So coming back to this slide, so please present, sir. Okay, so we saw teaching the machine to become a Shakespeare. So we saw a machine generating a sequence, but it is still meaningless. So we saw something. So what we saw, the possibility of a machine. So next thing is generating music from, again, just like we made a Shakespeare machine, now we are going to make a music machine. So can you please play that music? Just press on that music button, that speaker button.
Sir, it's not coming.
Maybe let me try 1 second. Like, let me share the screen.
Okay.
Okay, I'm getting it. Can everybody hear this? Yes. Is it audible? The music?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So that was some nice piece of music. And this music is actually not made by a human. This is actually a work of an AI. So let's see. So this music is actually a quite complicated piece of music because it involves so many instruments. So in order for us to teach a machine to play all those instruments at the same time, it's a very tedious task. So we'll just see in a basic, a single instrument, how can we train a machine? So I'll show a simple example of that. So if you can see the screen, so I'm going to we are going to train the machine to play a single instrument, maybe two instruments, and make a music. That means we give in a 30-second input, and the machine will generate the rest of the music. So let's see that. And mind you, this is actually a very simple piece of code. What we heard just now was a machine that generated music with very complicated code and which ran for thousands of hours. That means you'll need dedicated servers to run a machine that powerful and for such a long period of time. So let's hear that music. It's a very simple piece of music. I run to teach it the pattern of this music. So that is what actually is happening here. So what you're seeing is that you can see that something is written as epoch 1 out of 100. That is, I actually instructed this machine that please go through this 30-second piece of music 100 times. Or basically, it's like, imagine this was a human. I'm actually saying, if this was a human, it's like me saying to that person, please listen to this 30-second piece of music for 100 times. So imagine 30-second into 100. So 30-second into 100 is 3,000 seconds. So you can imagine. So it will be roughly like 50 minutes. So it's like the machine is running for as if the machine is learning as if a man was hearing a music for 50 minutes. So it has actually gone through it. It is going through that. Again, you can see here the loss value. The loss value is again, like in school, students get positive marks. But in AI, machines actually get negative marks. The student who gets least negative marks is the topper in the world of AI, not just like humans. So that is the key takeaway here. So I think it's... finished, I guess. So, yeah, it's finished. So 100 times. Okay, anyway, it didn't take 50 minutes. So the machine was very quick. So I'm going to make this is the code that is making the music. So you can see that it is making different set of sounds. So it made a music, and let's hear the music. So not much complicated, a very simple piece of music. So this was a simple demonstration of a machine turning into a musician. So this is a very simple example, not Very simple compared to the one I showcased in the slide. Okay, so the final demo. So that is generating dinosaur names. So dinosaur names, we know, for, as a general sense, we know dinosaur names ends with saur, rex, all those stuffs. So we are basically going to ask the machine, please, if I give you some dinosaur names, can you please generate for me some new names? And let's see that as well. So actually, I'm giving it 1,536 names. I'll show that names. Okay, so here is the input sequence that I'm providing to the machine. This is the textbook. This is the textbook that I'm lending to the machine. Look at this textbook and understand the structure of the names. So you can see so many actual dinosaur names. So I'm going to train the machine. So I'm running this code, some code. So I'm going to run the model. That is asking the machine to please generate some names for me. So the machine has started doing it. At the first iteration, at the first epoch, see the loss value and see the names it generated. The names it generated initially is completely random. It does not make any sense. But as you move down, as it progresses, its learning journey we do. You can see Saurus. So it is actually inputting some names and its loss is decreasing. So we actually got some promising results. So now AI can actually generate names for you. So this is again. So these were actually the practical apps that why was the model so stupid? Because Shakespeare cannot be understood by just by his 154 sonnets, that is 154 poems. And we just did only 1001 epochs. One epochs meaning 1000 actually was did even before. That means I did it even before coming to this talk. So we just did a single epoch today, so totally 1001. So Shakespeare has already written 37 plays, playwrights. He's also a famous playwright, just like Romeo and Juliet, Hamlet, and etc. So if you want to make a poem just like Shakespeare, you need to understand him well. You cannot understand, you cannot believe to understand Shakespeare just through his 154 sonnets. You need to understand, if you need to make a greater understanding of Shakespeare, you need to go through all his works. But currently our model only relied on his 154 sonnets only. So this was our statement. So we just used one epoch today, what I did 1000 before this. So, and then for the case of music, it was not that great. The reason is that it was like the music input sequence that I gave was only less than 30 seconds. And the number of instruments used were very less. So the diversity of music was very less. And hence we heard not so different, like we heard a music that was not so different from the input music. So we say that music was biased. Biased meaning, like you give a textbook and you ask the machine or that kid, the kid being the machine, the AI, and give ask him back to give me another piece of music that you generated out of the understanding that you got from the textbook. What we obtained was a new piece of music that was very much similar to the input one. So we can't blame the kid or the AI, the infant AI, because he had very less diversity in the inputs we gave. So the piece of music or the music we heard was we gave as an input was less diverse. So if we want to make a musician out of an AI, we need to give highly diverse piece of music. So it just complicates things. So why I didn't include this in this in our talk is that it will become very much complicated and will not get contained in this short period of time. So then again, the case of dinosaur. Again, it was okay, but again, dinosaur names are actually generated, are actually made either by naming it after the person who discovered it, or by the body structure, or the place where the fossil was unearthed. So we didn't give any such context. We didn't communicate any such context to the machine. We just said, these are the names. Based on the names, give me some new names. So the machine did not have any context. So there is a chance that the machine will give you a name that is not apt for the situation. That means if you unearth a new dinosaur fossil somewhere, and you the actual naming, human-based naming, the most accurate naming is human-based naming. The human-based naming will be something, and the machine-based naming will be something else. So what I meant to say is that the model that we saw is very, very rudimentary or primitive. So wrapping up, so what we came to understand is that an RNN can become an expert. It can become an expert in playing any musical instrument, because any piece of music is just a series of numbers or signals. So it can play many instruments at the same time, at the same level of expertise, because if a human was to do it, he'll need a lot of years. And we saw that the machine is achieving the same feat in a very, in matter of minutes, maybe seconds. So become a singer, and maybe it can extrapolate a movie. Imagine a movie to be a sequence of scenes. Give so many movies as inputs, and another sequence as the next sequence as true value, and teach the machine to predict that. Imagine you have a favorite movie and you feel that the movie got over so fast. Then you can train a machine and make this machine predict what should be, like extend this. That is, just like generating music, you can generate movie scenes with your favorite stars. So that is another possibility. So the basic understanding is that how much good our AI becomes depends on the amount of training that we will give. So infinite epochs. So I'm just saying the theoretical aspect. This is not at all may or may not be practical. I'm just saying, if it's infinite epoch, we get a master AI. And when we think about it, if we were to train an AI for that much amount, we'll have to think about some other things, about the carbon footprint it might cost, because AI is going to take off so high in the coming time period because of the current situation. So we'll have to think about the AI researchers, we'll have to think about the carbon footprint AI training AI will generate, because AI is trained in machines. Machines will emit heat, and these machines should be manufactured, results in carbon footprint generation, which will result in climate change. So this is another problem associated in this field. Then comes the associated thing, rising carbon levels, carbon dioxide levels will make us stupider. So why did I bring this here is that if we were to build master AIs, we will have to emit more carbon dioxide. That will in turn result in making master AIs, but the humans will become stupider. That is, creation will become more smarter than the creators. So that is one case. So that these are actually the research paths. So I just mentioned that. So again, what about human brain? Because for any AI to be successful, it needs data. So data should be stored somewhere. So we know human brain has infinite potential, which is actually year by year, scientific estimate is only growing. That is, we are only beginning to understand the depth of human storage capability. So right till now, what we know is that human brain can store up to 2.5 petabytes, which roughly translates to 2,000 people's lifetime story. That means their lifetime, which is assuming everybody lives up to an average 70 years in HD format. So our brain can store that. So how can we build such a storage device to build a master AI? So that is, and the reason why I brought human brain is that human brain is an organic machine with no carbon footprint. So if we want to make master AI and not leave carbon footprint, we'll have to think about replicating the biological human brain itself. So that is the reason why I brought this here. So as a conclusion, a quick question, like at the inception of Corona, like when a person you knew, your acquaintance, your relative, if they came to you wearing a mask, it might have been difficult for you to recognize those person. So day one, you come, you see those person coming in mask. When they unveil their mask, you see, you understand, oh, this was this person. And this day two comes, you will fail to understand. Again, he or she unveils the mask. You understand, okay, this is the person. And right after so much period of time, now we have come to understand that, like, given the top portion, that is the portion with mask is hidden, and the topmost portion is very well exposed. By looking at the previous sequence, that is, your brain slices the person's face vertically, and the brain is predicting the sequences after the beginning of the mask. Or basically, what your brain is doing, your brain is predicting what is under the mask region, or your brain is actually sequence predicting what is inside or behind the mask. So I just got this because our brain is right now doing this. That is identifying a person even though his face is partially hidden. So this is one daily life application of sequence modeling. So thank you all for hearing me. I hope my talk was useful to you guys. So thank you again, and stay safe and stay curious.
Thank you, Aurangzeb. It was a very interesting session. I think you have explained everything in a simple way, good presentation, and with good examples, and also with a few hands-on explanation. And the program running and showing the output, it was interesting and it was full, as you said. And one question from my side is, so why do you want to create another Shakespeare or one person? If you want to create some poems, what is the need for another Shakespeare? Shakespeare have experience. So what is the thing creating another Shakespeare with machines?
Like there was a, like, when you asked... Pardon?
Out of curiosity only, I'm asking, not A or anything. I'm just asking, what is the need for a Shakespeare or other machine, as like someone else? So we need
We need diversity. Yes, that's actually a very good, nice question, because the same question was actually asked in one of TED Expo, that is a TED Talk. Like it was something related with deepfakes. I believe some of you might have heard about deepfakes. Deepfake is about creating a person's video replica. That means you can make someone, like, you can make a video about someone that someone actually did not do. That means you can make Obama talk maybe in Malayalam and show its video. So in the same talk, there was a question just like this one. If we all had these kind of personality, why do we need to recreate them again? So to that, the same person, is actually, his name is quite difficult to pronounce, so I'm not using his name. So he's actually Japanese origin, I guess. So he mentioned about a famous teacher. His first name is John. So he was a very good teacher. So what he said, he responded to the same question, is that he was a great teacher, that George something, I don't actually recollect his name. So that George was a great teacher. So won't it be great for the like, he was a great teacher, so won't it be great for the students of this era to experience such a master, so that they get better understanding of the teacher? So just like that, maybe there are, like, the all whatever happening in the AI domain is completely experimental right now, but maybe there are people who might have felt like we haven't got enough of Shakespeare, we need more of it. So maybe, I'm not saying this is a production grade product, But still, there may be persons or people or audiences who are maybe hungry for more Shakespeare. You want to hear more or something like that. So this is all happening based on some curiosity. And again, I believe it's a valid point. That means we already had a Shakespeare, and why do we need more Shakespeare? We need new kinds of talent. I too agree with that. But again, there are different kinds of audience. So I believe that that might be some kind of answer.
A good answer. That's okay. But one more question is that if Shakespeare was here today, he might have written about some of his experiences gathered through the right, about some experience or some story he has heard from someone, occasions, situations.
Yeah.
Why don't we give some input also along with Shakespeare thing poems, so that we get some situation wise Shakespeare poems?
Yeah, you are asking that, like, if we give in inputs about his like out of profession interviews and all those things, and based on that make points or place.
Yes. So no, Shakespeare is not here just now, but if he was there for the past 20, had experiences in this world, so experiences he might have written some poems. If we give these situations or experiences to the manually or to the programs, if we give those inputs, we will get some experience poems.
Yeah, you mean like give the current experiences? This machine will give you contemporary poems that Shakespeare would have written if he was alive right now.
Yeah.
This machine is trying to do now. That is what I meant, that the hidden layer is generating an understanding of Shakespeare. It is not actually replicating his poem. That hidden layer is understanding Shakespeare via the sonnets. That is the drawback, because right now I only communicated to the machine only about Shakespeare's sonnets. I didn't give the machine any knowledge about Shakespeare's personal conversations, his playwrights, or anything. So that is why the model generated such meaningless phrases. So if we were to train the machine with all the experiences, that is, if we had all the documentaries of Shakespeare, all those stuffs, if we were to give that as an input to the machine, obviously, and give the current scenario, that is, give, like, the world is currently experiencing a pandemic. What is your take on this? If we give such a kind of input, the Shakespeare machine will generate a corresponding output. And as an interesting note, there is actually, if you Google it, you can find there is an algorithm that has generated an interview with Einstein. That is an AI that generated an interview. That is, it generated the question from the interviewer as well as the output from Einstein at the same time. And you can actually go through those. It's actually available in Google. When you go through it, you will see that the machine has like almost responded as if how an enlightened person would talk. You will be amazed how that machine has is observing things and speaking about things. So such a thing is possible. And if we combine these things with Shakespeare, obviously we can make Shakespeare write new poems, not just continue his poems.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for listening. I'm satisfied with your answer. Thank you.
Yeah, glad to hear.
Having any questions? Any else very interesting questions you can ask?
It was a wonderful talk. Though we have exceeded the time period with the demonstration and your insightful explanation. I do hope that the young minds are really excited. Thank you so much for joining us even during this Eid period. I do understand that you have rituals there at your home at this time, PD. But apart from that, you know, you joined us and you enlightened us. That is really appreciating from our side.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. It's my pleasure.
Shali ma'am, you're not audible now.
Hello, am I audible now?
Can you just come close to the mic, ma'am?
Hello.
Yeah, now it is audible, ma'am.
It is a wonderful talk. We really enjoyed it. But one more point I wanted to add is that because AI, it is advancing a lot. And even you must have heard of people, there are real people, those who are not existent. So it has even a controversial AI that comes in 1920. So there are certain things like that. We need to look at the AI ethics also. How far we can go with the AI. But there is one side of that, but still AI has to be a powerful tool to build a lot of things, even as a musician or a Shakespeare. Well narrated, very good, very good talk.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your kind words. Thank you.
Please have any questions in the session.
Malavika? No more queries, then I think we can wind up. Malavika?
Yes.
So we have reached the end of this wonderful section. First of all, I thank Aurangzeb sir for enlightening us about sequence models and AI terminologies with your intriguing talk. Now I thank Josnia ma'am for chairing the section. I would like to extend my heartiest thanks to all those who joined the section. Once again, thank you all.
Thank you.